Hello there. Do you have a lot of services that are using JSON? You don't want to switch to a data format that requires a schema, but you want better performance? Well, those are the same motivation that pushed us to implement yet another JSON binary format. Yajbe is a compact binary data format built to be a drop-in replacement for JSON. The main motivation was to reduce the overhead of JSON format in terms of performance and in terms of space and memory used. The main example that triggered us were services that uploaded and returned large list of objects, which ends up using a lot of memory during encoding by encoding over and over the same set of field names. Our main goals were reduce the space overhead of duplicate field names, reduce the overhead of integer, boolean and other values, support raw binary data with JSON. You always end up encoding binary as base64, which adds an extra 30% overhead. By moving to a binary format, we end up with a faster decode, since we don't have to scan for tokens, end of strings, and so on. Every length is explicit, so we know how much to allocate and how much we have to read. The encoding part should be faster, since we allocate less, having more compact format. The spec should be simple enough to be able to implement it in a day, and it should be a drop-in replacement. For example, in Java, we use JSON. We will replace JSonMapper with Yajbe mapper, and that's it. The same should be true for other languages like JavaScript, Typescript, Python, and others. Let's see how the format looks like and where we are able to reduce the overhead. Booleans and null are easy to see. Being a text format with UTF-8 encoding, null, false, true are strings. So null is 4 characters, which means 4 byte. False is 5 byte, true is 4 byte. In a binary format, it's easy to map those values as a single byte. Moving on to something more complex. Integer values in text format will use a lot of space. Each digit is a byte. A 20-digit number in binary can be encoded using 9 bytes, saving a lot of space. As many other binary formats, we have an header byte that identifies the type of the value. But we can be a bit clever and packing some information near the type identifier. So we can encode small values between -23 and 24 in a single byte. If the value is outside that range, we use the header to identify if the number is positive or negative and how many bytes are following. We store values as little endian, but we remove 24 or 25 from the original value. So with one extra byte, the value is a bit higher than the usual 255. If you go on GitHub, there will be more information. Moving on to the interesting part. To reduce the overhead of field names, we keep track of field names that we have already seen, and we are associating an index to each field. When we are encoding the field name, we check if the field was never seen before, we write the field name. Otherwise, we write the index of the field. Furthermore, before writing the full field name, we check if the current field name has a prefix or a suffix in common with the previous one, and we write only the delta. Similarly to the int encoding that we have seen before, we have an header byte that describes the type of the field name. It may be a full field name, a field name with only a prefix, a field name with a prefix and a suffix, or an index. Again, similarly to the int encoding, we pack inside the header the length of the field name or the index. And if it does not fit, we use external bytes in a similar way we did for integer values. Arrays and maps have a few special cases. If the array or map is empty, we'll use a single byte. If the array or map was written in a streaming fashion, the head will say streaming array or streaming map, and we place an end of array, end of map after the last item. In all the other cases, we have a length that can be inlined with the header if the number of items is low, or we use the same trick of the integers and the length is stored externally. Similarly, string and bytes have a special case when empty, which will use a single byte. Otherwise, the length will be written in line or externally, followed by the raw bytes. Since strings are quite common, we have designed the format to be able to use a single byte to identify strings with less than 60 characters. For an extra compression memory saving, we have an option that enables what we call enum mapping. In JSON, enums are generally expressed using strings. And not being able to identify enums, we use a probabilistic approach. We keep track of most common strings, and after a certain threshold, we write an index instead of the full string. More or less, it is the same idea that we used for field names. But the problem here is that we cannot keep track of every string, since we expect them to be a lot of more than the fields. So the algorithm here is a bit more clever, and there can be multiple implementation, from a simple LRU to a count min sketch or something else. More or less, these are the main things you should know about Yajbe. To learn more, check out the GitHub repo for both the code and the specs. And if you are interested in contributing, feel free to open a pull request on GitHub. That's all for today. If you have any question or feedback, please let me know in the comment below.